Joseph Addison wrote, "When all thy mercies, O my God, my rising soul surveys, transported with the view, I'm lost in wonder, love, and praise." Dana Niskanen was the daughter of a professional shepherd. You don't hear about that very much anymore. Her dad was a professional shepherd at the University of Minnesota. So Dana grew up loving sheep. And when I came here, we would, we had a few jokes about all of us dumb sheep. We didn't want to be sheep. And Dana said, "Oh, I love sheep." So Dana loved sheep. She also knew we weren't real bright. So anyway, nice to have your sheep here this morning. A little girl repeating the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," said it this way: "The Lord is my shepherd, that's all I want." It's not bad, is it? The Lord is my shepherd, that's all I want. That's all I need to know, really. It's who the shepherd is. But this matter of who the shepherd is and how to understand the shepherd is no simple matter, is it? We Christians have a tradition that goes back to the early church. It does not go back to Scripture, incidentally, called the Trinity. You won't find the Trinity in the Bible. You'll find it reading the Bible and putting one and two together and getting three. But the Bible does not preach the Trinity. And so in the Bible study last Monday morning, one of our astute members in the Bible study said, "I really have a hard time believing that Jesus was God. I just don't know. I mean, I think Jesus was a human being, and Jesus was the Son of God, but I just don't get this, that Jesus was God." How about you? Was Jesus human, or was Jesus God, or was he both somehow? The doctrine of the Trinity says that there are three persons: Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, or Holy Spirit, right? Three persons. But in the language in which the doctrine of the Trinity was framed, a person was not an individual. A person was not people. So you don't have Father over here and then Jesus over here and the Holy Spirit over here. Can't see the Spirit, but you know what I mean. I mean, you don't have three people. God is not three people. The word person that we say, when you talk about the persons of the Trinity, is the Greek word persona. In the plural, personae. And what is a persona? A persona on the Greek stage. You are all in the theater of the Greek theater. And in the Greek theater, very often, a single actor, and that still happens now. I mean, you can watch. Who was it that played Mrs. Doubtfire? I mean, very funny story, but, you can play, or Bill Murray does this a couple of times. You can see him, he's playing a couple of different roles. He just looks different, right? different disguise. Well, in the Greek theater, a single actor would often play different roles. Sometimes it was the actor played a young man or a boy and wore the mask of the young child. Sometimes that same actor would play the role of an old man or woman, wear the mask. And sometimes it would be something else. The same actor, but three, from our perspective, three different personae. Well, how do you and I, who sit in the theater of God's glory, how do we experience God? Is the Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, an eternal existence of three distinct persons, or are the three personae of the Trinitarian formula three different ways in which you and I experience God? Think about water. Water is water, isn't it? It's just water. Well, sometimes it appears as ice, doesn't it? Sometimes water appears as snow, doesn't it? Still water. It's all water. So the Trinitarian formula is water, snow, and ice. The three different faces of water. In the conversation on Monday, and what I want to say to you now is that there is no question in my mind, none, that Jesus was as human as you and I are. No question. And the letter to the Hebrews says exactly that. The letter to the Hebrews says nothing about a virgin birth, neither did Paul, incidentally. The Apostle Paul, who had the earliest writings that circulated among the church, there was no mention of a virgin birth. That came later with Matthew and with Luke, not in Mark and not in John. In the letter to the Hebrews, what you have is the second person of the Trinity, Jesus as the Christ, being adopted or chosen by God as the anointed one to show us how to live as a human being, to show us how to be the kingdom of God, how to live in the kingdom of God right here and right now. It's very, very clear. But Jesus cries out to God with loud cries and prayers. Just like you. Just like I or me, whichever it's supposed to be. Just like us. And what in this Christology, Jesus, the human being who is appointed and led by the Spirit and crucified, is raised from the dead to sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from whence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I love the Trinity myself. I love the Trinity. I think in Trinitarian terms. I'm also, and some people would say, well, you're not a Trinitarian. You're a Universalist and a Unitarian. In some ways I am. In some ways I am a Roman Catholic. I love the Mass. I love the liturgy. In some ways I'm an Episcopalian. I love the Episcopal liturgy. In some ways, I'm a Pentecostal. When Momo's at the piano, I'm a Pentecostal. Who can't be a Pentecostal when Momo or Linda's fingers are flying across that keyboard and there's such joy in this room? And I look out and I see the smiles. I am, sometimes I'm water, sometimes I'm ice, sometimes I'm snow, sometimes I'm sleet, and often between 2 and 4 o'clock, I'm asleep. So this matter of the Trinity is a way of pointing to the majesty and the mystery of God, the utter, complete transcendence of God. Who can even begin to conceive of God? Augustine said none of us can. Augustine, St. Augustine, who wrote the Confessions and who wrote the City of God, said, God is best known in not knowing him. God is more truly imagined than expressed, and he exists more truly than imagined. And finally, we can know what God is not, but we cannot know what God is. How can anyone looking out through the Hubble telescope at the far reaches of what we now understand to be this universe and the galaxies and the other universes, how can we begin to say that we know who God is? Well, we get a sip of it. We get a taste of it. And we say, as the brothers and sisters of Jesus, that the one who humbled himself and who said to John and James, the sons of Zebedee, you guys are off your rocker. This is not about power. It's not about privilege. This life is not about sitting at anybody's right hand in power or privilege. Knock it off. That I don't have anything to do with that. God does. And then he flips the whole thing of this ladder of power and privilege, of getting to the top of the ladder where there really, you know, is nothing, according to the Tower of Babel story. It's empty up there. He flips it and says, as Martin Luther King did, you want to be great? You want to be great? Be the servant of all. That's it. Be the servant of all. That's greatness. And those who don't serve are not great. He redefines the whole thing. And the whole thing is defined by love. By love. That's good enough for me. I need a God who is so much bigger than me. I don't need a puny little God. I don't need a God who can be manipulated and cajoled and tricked. I need a God who's so far beyond all that nonsense and who just says to me very quietly, why don't you just calm it down? Just calm it down and give thanks that you're alive. Isn't that a miracle? You're alive. Celebrate it. And there is there's a wonderful prayer in the Book of Common Worship, Common Prayer. that is offered at the end for those who have died. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant, Dana. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Enfold her in the arms of your mercy. In the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and in the glorious company of the saints in light. We have lots of light, brothers and sisters. Live in the light and give thanks to God for the light that is ours. Amen.